Thanks for joining us and being a part of our online worship community. We are here at Webster Gardens, are so grateful to have you with us today. Compared to this time last year, doesn't it seem like the world has gotten a little more and more anxious? Like maybe with the ongoing pandemic, heightened racial tensions, and disagreeable politics, there's more to worry about than ever before. But the Bible tells us that we are to be anxious about nothing. That we shouldn't let our hearts be troubled by the troubles in this world, because Jesus has overcome the world. What does that even mean? Well, pull up a chair, get a cup of coffee, grab your Bible and your Bible app, and dig in with us as we explore God's Word together, anxious for nothing.
We are here at Columbia Bottom Conservation Area, which has over 4,000 acres of conservation land. It looks like there's not a whole lot going on here, but right behind me is a field of sunflowers. Sunflowers are incredible flowers. If you've ever been to a field, you'll notice that they're really tall. The standard sunflower is 6 to 10 feet tall. But the tallest sunflower, which grew in Germany, grew to be 30 feet tall. Sunflowers are also incredible because they're not just one flower.
They are actually thousands of tiny flowers in one. And each tiny flower produces a seed. The seeds develop all summer long and are ready to harvest by fall. Just one sunflower produces 1 to 2,000 seeds.
Those are some pretty cool facts about the sunflower, but I think the most incredible thing about them is that they love the sun. Sunflowers love the sun so much that each young sunflower follows the sun. Wait a minute. How can sunflowers follow the sun when they're rooted in the ground? Okay, sunflowers don't literally get up and chase the sun. That would be weird. No, these sunflowers turn, so no matter what time of day it is, they are always facing the sun. So why do sunflowers love and chase the sun?
They know they need the sun to live, so they keep their eye on the sun all day long.
In the book of Matthew, Jesus talks about flowers and how God takes care of them.
They don't worry about what clothes they're going to wear or what's going to happen tomorrow. Yet God takes care of them. In the journey of life, it's easy for us to worry, especially when we face all kinds of trouble.
But our Father in heaven knows what we need, and He promises to take care of us.
So let's keep our eyes on Jesus, God's only Son. And remember, if God takes care of the sunflowers, then how much more will He take care of you?
That was awesome. Now let's listen to this from the Bible.
I know it's easy to worry about things, and I can easily fall into that pattern. I'll bet it's the same for you. Jesus' followers were the same way. He assured them. Picture Him reassuring you with these same words. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. This is the word of the Lord.
About 650 miles from here, it was a January day in a field in Louisiana, and a group of British soldiers marched against an American fortification in an attempt to capture the city of New Orleans during the War of 1812. There's a famous song about it that every baby boomer knows, and probably the rest of us might know too. Johnny Horton was singing about the Americans chasing the British down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico. I won't sing it for you, but it's worth checking out if you're not familiar. But the battle itself wasn't quite as jolly as that song would make it seem. After all the rifle and cannon fire had ended, and the British had been pushed back, after the breeze had blown away all the black powder smoke, the battle left 300 people lying dead and 1,300 wounded. You know, aside from the song, one thing that stands out about this battle is that it took place 2 weeks after the war had ended. The treaty had already been signed, declaring that the British wouldn't pursue the war any further, that they would withdraw, that they would return the land that they had taken back to the United States. I guess text messaging then wasn't what it is today, and so neither side there in Louisiana knew about that agreement yet. Ultimately, the Battle of New Orleans wasn't necessary. In many ways, you can look back at that battle, those lives that were lost, and you could say that battle was for nothing. Today, we start a new series called Anxious for Nothing. You know, we fight a lot of battles in our own lives. A lot of those battles are worries about the circumstances that come up day after day. Some of those battles aren't about things that happened, but things that might or might not happen. Some of those things don't just give us concern, but they consume us. So, just as we can look back at a historic battle and judge if it was really necessary, Jesus, who won the war for you, wants to challenge you to look at the worries and concerns you fix your eyes on. How much of that is a battle being anxious for nothing? You know, I really hope that you'll join us for these next 4 weeks. Maybe you'll share this with a friend who's experienced worries, which just means they're in the same boat that we're all in. My hope for you, for this series, is that it helps you fix your eyes on God so that you can put the things that make you anxious into perspective. And also, that God frees you up so you're not paralyzed by worry, but that you can take action. So right now, why don't you open up your Bibles or your phones to Matthew chapter 6. Jesus is in the middle of teaching his followers in what's famously known as the Sermon on the Mount. And he opens up this section saying, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life. So let's start there. What do you worry about? Worry is a highly personalized list, isn't it? If you have a piece of paper, why don't you write down your own list? I'm going to share a list that one news outlet compiled a few years ago. These are top things that people worried about. Work. Money, being late, a friend or relative's health or our own health, relationships, not waking up to our alarm, our appearance, our family's safety. This was in 2015. What would you add to that list in 2020? Race relations, politics, school starting back up safely, a job loss, seeing your grandkids, how to even go on a date, even just breathing in the air, there is no shortage of battles, stuff that we worry about. This whole series, and especially today, I want to challenge you to let Jesus question your worries. Because in this section, Jesus throws out a lot of questions. He says, isn't life more than food or clothes? Aren't you more important than birds? What does worrying add to your life? Won't God give you what you need? When Jesus says, don't worry, know that he isn't scolding you. Know that he isn't being dismissive. Jesus doesn't say that the things you worry about aren't important things. You should think about and you should act on circumstances in your life. You should plan and prepare for events in the future. But Jesus wants to give you perspective so that you aren't anxious for nothing. Last week we talked about humility. One mark of humility is being open to someone questioning you and being willing to learn. So let's be humble today. Let's drop our defenses and let's look at what Jesus in his love wants to show us. First, Jesus wants to show you the Father's heart. Say you're a mom or dad. You don't have to be, just imagine it. And your son or daughter has been saving up for a long time for something they've really wanted. Maybe it's a phone or even a car, or maybe it's for college, and they've worked hard. They've saved their birthday money for years. You're proud of them. You're excited for them. And then a friend talks them into taking that money and investing it instead in some pyramid scheme selling fidget spinners. And you know that last time you checked, it's not 2017, and nobody buys fidget spinners anymore. But the friend promises that no, just like COVID, there is going to be a second wave. And well, it's your child's money. But you love them and you desperately want your child to see that they're trading off some long-term hopes that they'd had. You want the very best for them. And you don't want 15,000 fidget spinners in your basement either. God wants the very best for you. Jesus points up and he says, look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Now, the Father doesn't force you to not worry, but he wants you to know how valuable you are to him, how much you matter to him. He sees the joy that he's created you to have with him. He sees the fruitful relationships that he's created you for. And he knows that worrying about the future is a trade-off of that meaningful life now. And he wants you to be free of those things because you matter to him. And it's not just that you're infinitely valuable to God. Jesus wants to show you the Father's power to provide for you. So Jesus tells you something that you might really need to hear today. He says, so do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. Jesus is saying, the people who don't know who God is worry about these things. But you know God. You know his power. And you know that your heavenly Father knows what you need. Say that out loud right now with me. Your heavenly Father knows what you need. If you're next to somebody, turn to them and say it. Your heavenly Father knows what you need. When you pray, ask God to show you what he knows. He knows what you need. He knows the troubles that you'll face. John even records Jesus saying flat out, in this world, you will have trouble. And the troubles that you face aren't nothing. They're something. They're the result of a broken world where there's sickness and death and evil and injustice. But if Jesus doesn't promise that the things you worry about will go away, he must be showing you a different way to look at them. You see, Jesus wants to reorder your perspective. Think back to when you've been in art class, or maybe you've been on a museum tour. In a painting or photo of a scene, you have the foreground and the middle ground and the background. Now, you can't see everything in the background. It looks smaller, and it's partly covered up by objects that are in the middle and in the foreground. Jesus wants you to examine what is in the foreground of your mind. Is it what other people have that you don't? Is it the daunting problem that you're facing? Or is it the one who provides for all of your needs? Jesus gives his thesis statement to this part of his message when he says, but seek first God's kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. God's kingdom belongs in the foreground, not covered up by anything else, any of the things we worry about. God's kingdom. For one thing, it's this promised future. It's with Jesus, a day that he returns and that everything is made right because it's with him. There's going to come a day when God's kingdom reigns completely over all of creation. But God's kingdom is also here right now, and he doesn't want you to miss it. It's the truth that Jesus is greater than your circumstances. It's a promise that he has forgiven your sins. It's a promise that right now he has called you to be a member of his family with him, and that you're connected to him and his people. When you reflect on that truth, other things won't remain in the foreground, because you realize that everything else is going to fail at some point. Jobs, relationships, your health. Those things are important, and your Father knows you need them. But they're not foreground material. God's kingdom is. You remember when Jesus made that promise, "In this world you will have trouble"? Let's look at the entire verse from John. I want you to say this along with me. Jesus said, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." Let's learn that section together over these next weeks. Learn it together with your friends or with your family. We're going to keep coming back to it. You know, there's a lot of freedom in that passage. Now think about, how does that freedom allow you to accomplish God's work? There was another study, and it found that the average person worries for just under 2 hours a day. That's about 28 days a year. And that was in 2015. You think you worry more now than then? When God's kingdom is first in your life, you're free to do the meaningful work that God has for you to do. To pray for someone else, to serve your neighbors, to share a truth or an encouragement from God's word with someone else. What could God do through you with an extra month? I want to invite you, keep joining us in these coming weeks. God's going to keep encouraging us together so that we're not anxious for nothing. I hope that you'll join us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Those who trust in the Lord are a strong mountain. They will not be moved. Those who trust in the Lord are a strong mountain. They will not be moved. Though the world moves like mad, you alone are faithful. Jesus, you will not be changed. Trust in the Lord are as Mount Zion. They will not be moved. Those who trust in the Lord are as Mount Zion.
Sets my feet
on a firm foundation.
Christ my King sets my feet on a firm foundation. They will not, be moved. Though the world moves like mad, you alone are faithful.
Live in a mad and crazy world. This is an age of anxiety. So instead, let's place our confidence in God and trust Him. Would you quiet yourself right now in God's presence and join me? Let's be honest before God about our sin and our failure to trust Him. Let's pray. God, here's the truth about me. I've wasted my time worrying instead of seeking you. I'm anxious about the future. It seems so uncertain. What's going to happen with the virus? What's going on in our own individual lives? What's going to happen in our country and our world? And God, I admit it. I'm not confident that you will always take care of my needs. So I try to do it on my own. And that doesn't work. Forgive me. Take my worry, replace it with trust and confidence in you. I pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Where will you place your confidence? My confidence is in the one who loved me so much he gave his son for me. My confidence is in the one who went to the cross and died for me and has power over sin and death. Know this. Have confidence in this. Jesus forgives you. He's overcome your sin. He has overcome the world. Trust Him. You have peace. Amen. Let's pray together our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. One of the ways that we demonstrate our trust in God is through our offerings. God will take care of us, He will provide for us, and we place our confidence in Him. If you're just checking us out online, don't feel obligated to bring an offering. But if we at Webster are your church home, what we do as disciples of Jesus is that we bring our offerings as an act of worship. You can participate by texting LCWG to 77977. You can give through our website, or you can mail your offering to us here on Watson Road. Please take the time and complete a communication card. Share with us prayer requests. Share with us needs that you might have. Share with us things that you're rejoicing about. We're the church together, and this is one of the ways that we demonstrate how we gather together. Hey, today begins our new Grow Deep reading plan. It's called Anxious for Nothing. And we're using the YouVersion Bible app. I am so excited about this. Our Grow Deep subscribers will receive daily text reminders with a link to the selected congregation-wide reading plan. Friends, don't be anxious. Instead, ground yourself in God's promises through Scripture every day. Here's the best thing about our new Grow Deep plan. You can invite your friends, or your small group, or your family to read along with you and share their thoughts that God has given to them. So, go ahead and download the YouVersion app, go to our website, Next Steps Grow Deep, and we'll walk you through everything that you need to do in order to be joining us in reading Scripture. This is great. So I encourage you, please join us for our new Grow Deep, Anxious for Nothing. And now, receive God's promises and God's blessings, the words that Pastor King shared with us, Jesus' words from John chapter 16. I have told you these things, Jesus said, so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world.
Thanks again for joining us in worship. Our hope is that you were emboldened and encouraged in your faith today. If you enjoyed your online experience with us or found some value in it, we would ask that you would share this link with somebody that you know. Another way to help people enjoy this worship is to click the like button on the video and subscribe to our YouTube channel. See you next time.